die Audi R8 Spider. Super Sports Convertible Time here on Autogefühl, your number one resource for in-depth car reviews and your number one community to discuss cars with Thomas. The new generation of the R8, now also with the open top. The first generation came in 2007, second generation 2015, and now with the roof demounted. We will show you all the details on exterior, interior and the driving performance, different driving situations, compare it to the previous generation and also to the coupe and also maybe to some of the competitors. Let's go now with Autogefühl in full HD, full screen and full length. Front with a crisp look, Audi single frame grille, really huge. Then with this matte gray huge front grille and LED lights are from standard equipment. An option you can get those ones here, the Matrix LED, also with laser lights. So also a good light at very high speeds. And the convertible, about 180,000 bucks, 14,000 more than the coupe. We'll see what do you get extra with the convertible style here. 4 meters 42 or 14 foot 5 is the total length of this vehicle. Super sports car style, not too long for a super sports car, but longer than an Audi TT, for example. Rims start with 19 inch, those ones here are the optional 20 inch. They stand out quite wide, have to be careful not to scratch them. Carbon ceramic brakes, those ones are optional. Usually they just come with the plus version. But the plus version is not available for the convertible. Let's say, okay, the V10 with 540 horsepower is enough here. And I think for the Spider, that's definitely the case. Open top at the moment, the convertible has been stiffened up right here at the A-pillar, the whole window frame, and also in the lower bumper area, because the same stiffness should be, well, at least almost the same stiffness should be achieved then with the coupe. Therefore, I had to strengthen those areas. So the weight is about 1,700 kilograms and they could keep it quite low because about 80% of the car is made from aluminum in the chassis construction. And if you compare it to the predecessor, the stiffness of the chassis has increased by about 50%. So as the engine here sets in the rear or in the center rear, as you would call it, also the air intakes are right here for the engine. And then the cover cap here, you can get it in black, for example, also in silver. Here it is in the carbon fiber style. The rear perspective is the most show-off one. And it's also 4 centimeters wider than the predecessor version. This is really strong, really massive with the black diffuser here, also in the carbon fiber style. And you have already heard something from the sound. Let's check out what can we see actually from that engine. And what can we see of the engine? Only when the ignition is turned on, you can, so not the engine, but the ignition, then you can open this cover here, and this is the V10 engine, so 10 cylinders, 540 horsepower, 5.2 liters of displacement, 3.6 seconds, 0 to 100 kilometers an hour or 61 miles an hour. Pretty massive, but with this rear engine design, we cannot see too much of it. And when we open the convertible top, or in this case, when we close it, see, you can take one more look maybe at the engine, see something more of it. Well, not too much to see. More there is to see with the convertible top. This is my new rear wing. Have you seen that one? Massive, isn't it? And there it's gone. So, raising up the windows and now the complete process again when the roof is being closed. Also works while driving. I will show you that in a very special camera perspective when we drive the car later, and you can count seconds here now below or scroll back and count them again, how much seconds this one took here to close the roof. Overall, with the soft top, is of course a big advantage that you have that one. If you compare it to hard top, the soft top always goes faster to open and close. And overall, I think very interesting process. And for that, we'll open it once more again for you, that you can see it. very spectacular in this case here. In the Audi TT, it's definitely a much simpler solution. There we go. And now we have a color overview for you. The Vegas yellow you've seen our main car for today. Definitely a screaming out color. Then Monterey green, very unusual. It looks like British racing green, and I think I've never seen an Audi in this color so far. Then dynamite red, explosive color there again. And my favorite choice would be the Ara blue. And here in Autogefühl, you know, this is also called Thomas blue because it's really my favorite bright blue color. Which one would you go for? Let's get inside. Door handles are right here, a little bit hidden. Then open the car, beeping sound because the ignition is turned on. You see, it's a very sporty layout, of course. Flattened button at the steering wheel, all driver focused. A lot of contrast stitches here are used, here in yellow, fitting to the Vegas yellow. And a little disappointment, I've only seen animal skin available as for the surface. There was an Alcantara middle part, but I don't find it in the configurator yet anymore. I'm not sure they should step up the game and offer more alternatives, especially for such a sporty car. Take a seat, ladies and gentlemen, together with me, and always clean your shoes before entering such a car. And of course, all cars. You sit, of course, low as you're used to in a super sports car, but it's relatively comfortable for a super sports car. And good racing position, definitely. I mean, the overview is not too good because everything behind you is a little bit higher. Those ones are the normal sports seats. They offer you good shoulder support already. Don't go for the bucket seats. They are too uncomfortable. Only if you just plan it for racetrack driving, then it maybe helps, you know, to not shake around that much. Otherwise, those ones will do just fine. Electric control, front and rear, also for the back part of the seats. And you can also electronically pump up the sides. Steering wheel is my personal highlight. This is really an airplane cockpit here with a start-stop button. Then for the exhaust, if you ever want to have more sound, we will test it when we drive the car. The race mode for the racetrack to draw back the stability control, and not that harsh, the drive select for more comfortable suspension, or again, drawing in the dynamic mode, the ESP a little bit further back and to give it more dynamic also from a suspension. And view, for example, to adapt the virtual cockpit, soon more details to that. And you can control everything basically here at the steering wheel already. You don't need anything else, as it's all driver focused. The virtual cockpit always comes with the R8, always in the digital screen, and you have different modes here, of course, the racing with big RPM. Then you can also change the view, that you have music choice in the middle part, consumption, or also the GPS here with a satellite view. It lasts, you know, with the contract, with buying a new car. Later on, you'll have to pay for it, and you can zoom in and out. Very impressive, definitely. Of course, can change it right again. Also connect your phone, for example, via Bluetooth. That's the one choice, and go back to the racing mode again. However, you can also control the infotainment system from here, and again, with those nice Audi clicking sounds. You can use this one as a touchpad to type an address in, like A, B and whatever, and then it will appear on the GPS. Shortcuts to radio, media, the map or the phone. The phone you can also connect via cable with the smartphone interface for Apple CarPlay and Android Auto. Going to the menu and back and so on. This one is to open and close the roof. The electric wind deflector, the glass one, parking brake, and then the shifting stick for the S-tronic dual clutch transmission. And the key. Here we have the key with a nice Audi logo. It's not the newest one, rather an old school style with an R8 logo, however, and a spot where you can store it safely. The Evans have a carbon frame right here and overall a very clean setup. Then I like those vents you can control right here, temperature and vent strength. Seat heating would be here for driver and co-driver. Again, this airplane cockpit style. And storage spaces here below. You can put your sunglasses in, for example, but also the smartphone. This is the place where you can have the inductive charging for your smartphone and also with the USB supplies. Storage is really limited. However, here you can put some beverages. This one is here for smokers, but I don't know. I would not smoke in this car, so you can have two beverage holders. And then there's another storage space right here, but you can hardly put anything in there, even not glasses. This is for the emergency kit, and here for the GPS, for SIM card and so on. But again, very limited in the space. And at the inside of the doors, you can just put some smaller bottles horizontally. At least you got a normal glove box sliding down smoothly with reasonable space. And again, everything you see is from a great build quality as we used to from Audi. And you can also expect that, I think, for such a price. But that's not with all exotic super sports cars. And when the roof is closed, by the way, still got plenty of headroom. Also good for a super sports car. I'm 1.86 meters. In height or 6'1", still a good result and better than other super sports cars. And then another total cockpit overview for you with this clean Audi design. What is your opinion? Put me yours in the comments. And one more look at the trunk. The first unlocking happens either at the inside of the doors or with the key, and then it's very easy. You don't have just to put your hand below this mechanism here, then it opens. Here we got the storage, for example, for the manual wind deflector, so you can mount that one here. That is more effective than the glass one, but of course you have to manually mount and demount it always. And then there's, well, not too much space left here. You can put a backpack in here, but that's about it. And when I think about going with two people, that already gets critical. And let's start our cruise with the Audi R8 Spider in the new generation. And one of the biggest changes they have done from the previous to this generation is making the car more comfortable and sporty at the same time. And that means when you're just riding here calmly like this at first, it's really not uncomfortable. Also the suspension, I mean the car sits extremely low, but still the suspension is, you know, totally comfortable, and that is definitely a step forward if you compare it to the last generation. And of course, if you have those roundabouts here, they always invite you to drive a little sportier. And what a handling. Look at this, how fast my commands are transported onto the road. It feels like driving Mario Kart. You have a direct input to the wheels on the road, and every roundabout is just so much fun to drive. Look at that. The car is really gluing to the road. Driving like 50 now and no problem at all. There, the car is a little bit wet here. Then you have to correct a little bit, but you see the electronic stability control also did the job. And you can also draw that back. Then you have to steer, counter steer yourself a little bit more. That's really amazing how the car feels. Look at this when you go to slalom here. And the car can also be relatively sideways. Look at, really incredible what you can do with this car. Also turning circle like this here, absolutely no problem. And if you're just in the normal riding mode, you can hammer the throttle at any time, and this naturally aspirated engine will give you the kick immediately, and also gives the automatic downshift from the dual clutch transmission. But if you want to control it more on your own, because you've seen, if you're driving very calmly and then hammer the throttle, it sets in, you know, relatively extreme. So it's also more comfortable for you if you, for example, use the shifting pedals, then go back. Third gear, for example, and then you have a very harmonic acceleration from this naturally aspirated engine. Very interesting. You can always go back to the auto mode again, for example, just putting the shifting lever here. Stop sign. And we're at the moment just testing the normal mode. Some acceleration, guys. So that was 0 to 120, and of course here in the Spider you can very, very well hear the sound. That's great, and also a reason I would always go for the convertible version of this car here. At the same time, due to the all-wheel drive, we have a very constant acceleration, and you've maybe also heard it. We just had a little bit wheel spin at the rear, and what is really interesting is when you use the launch control, we did that with the R8 Coupe. You can also check out that video. When you use that one, it leaves no traces of rubber on the ground, and that's really astonishing to have the best performance, not the most screaming out one too, with burning tires and stuff, but the best performance, really interesting. You can always go to the S mode, then you also hear car shifting down, shifting up later, shifting down earlier. And in the sport mode, we also have the exhaust activated, the exhaust valve. Wow, that's some true NA sound. Go back to the D mode, and the car is relatively silent again. And you can also activate it with the separate exhaust motor sound sport. Then you also have it. In the drive select, you can pick auto as we have at the moment, or comfort, also for suspension. If you go for dynamic, also the S mode is activated, the sport mode and the exhaust again. We also have more feedback, a little bit stiffer from the road, better for the racetrack, for example. And you immediately feel it at lower speeds already. Very interesting. And you can also go to an individual mode to set individual characteristics. And this is really funny how you can change that car here from a rather comfortable cruising convertible to a pure race super sports car machine just by this button here. Or just acoustically by the exhaust button. What do you think about the sound, guys? Oh, when you're using the brakes, shifting down, and then you can also very well hear the sound. Oh, policia. Should we follow the police? Why not? So even at lower speeds now, when you have the exhaust activated, it gives you a very great sound, definitely. About wind, we will also soon test it on the motorway. What you can do is raise this electric wind deflector. That one is possible to reduce a little bit. And there's also a fixed one available that you can put behind, and it has a little bit more effect. Basically, it is a summertime convertible. It's not like, for example, an A5 doesn't block the wind off that well. At the moment, it's still warm enough. And what is also very spectacular, you can also close the roof while driving and look at the camera we have mounted on there, because that really works. So we'll do it while driving now, closing the roof. Also a very spectacular process. Hope you enjoyed that one. Very interesting. And now we also have it rather silent in here. Audi always offers a good sound insulation. That means the car will also remain calm at the motorway, for sure. But of course, you maybe sometimes want to hear the motor sound, but I think they have found a good setup that when you're driving in a normal, rather comfortable mode, that you have, you know, not so much sound around you, because sometimes you maybe want to drive rather silently. And you can also compare it when I go to the S mode here again now, how you can hear that sound here when the roof is closed. I think you've noticed a difference. Of course, it's always better when the roof is opened, and that's the main difference. The coupe version is more silent if you have in comparison to the roof closed here, but Audi uses those acoustic covers here, so for convertibles they are still relatively silent, definitely. So if you enjoy open top riding, so you definitely should go for the convertible. The question is also, how much difference does it make in price if you're buying such cars here? I mean, 14,000 euros extra for the Spider, that's a lot of money. It's sometimes the total cost of a car. But maybe the price does not matter that much if you're buying this segment. Let me lower the roof once more. You can see this great process right again. We're driving 40 kilometers at the moment, by the way. It works until a speed of 50. And that's also very handy if you come into a sudden rain, then you're still able to close the roof and protect yourself against the rain. That's very good, definitely. So how do you feel when driving this car in the city? You feel that you're driving in a super sports car, it's sitting very low, definitely, and there are also more comfortable cars, because you have always to be aware of that you don't get maybe lower back pain at some point. Also, we have to be very slow when going over speed bumps here, for example. But for a super sports car, I think they have gotten a lot of comfort out of the car. Also, I'm satisfied with the seat form so far. Those sport seats offer you good side support. There are also those bucket seats available, which I do not recommend. I've driven that one on the racetrack once in the R8 Coupe. This is really not comfortable. It's maybe suitable for the racetrack, but for nothing else. That's the basic problem with it. This car also has a start-stop function, but that won't really help so much with consumption. I mean, consumption shouldn't be the biggest matter for you here. At the moment here, this car is running 100 kilometers, 3 hours, 20 liters of consumption. Yeah, so we shouldn't expect too much as for the consumption from this car. Definitely not. And what's also interesting, I can browse into the map while driving the car. Slow again at the speed bumps. This is also a good use for the car. Not so many people go with this car on the racetrack, but here, street with palm trees, showing off a little bit and greeting some of your fellows, maybe getting someone in for a ride, listening to the sound. That's also what you would do with this car, for example. I can very well see that satellite view while driving, but what I do realize, satellite view does look very fancy, but then again, it offers a better overview when you don't have a satellite view and rather have the schematic display. What a handling, look at that. And it's so easy. Really rather feels like a computer arcade game when driving this car, so a little bit unreal. See, I can also always change the view of the virtual cockpit. I also have this total view of the GPS map. So I can even see the ocean on the left side here now. And well, again, that's fancy, but the overview again is better in a schematic view. Usually when you drive the car, you have the view set to the big RPM mode that you can see the RPMs turning up together with the sound, and you can also follow the digital speedometer and, for example, also the G meter. So overall, this is one of the very few cars left without a turbo. I think that's basically rather good than bad. If you want, you could drive those naturally aspirated engines also with a lower consumption. That is definitely possible. But yet again, when you drive such a car, you often hammer the throttle just for fun, and then of course it's a natural thing, the consumption goes very, very high. Just pure enjoyment here in a convertible, so I would definitely always go for that one. Oh no, we can enter there now. Wow. Sometimes you just have to tip the throttle and then you hear that sound again. Or if you want to annoy your neighbors, you always have to think about that. Where do you activate the exhaust note? And yeah, if you have it on sport, just a little notch on the throttle and you already have this overwhelming sound. Especially when you hear it from the outside, it's even stronger probably than when sitting here on the inside. You know, you always have to think about that. And I mean, some respect for some people maybe not enjoying that as much as you do is always, you know, not a bad thing. We're gonna head to the motorway also for a part. I can tell you something more about wind features and also hammer throttle a little bit more. That's of course also a part. If you rather enjoy putting that one here on the racetrack in the R8 Coupe review, we also put that car here on the racetrack. So we've did also the normal version we have here now, and the plus version with even a little bit horsepower more. So you can check that one out as well there. The convertible is definitely more about also, you know, having the car for cruising than for sporty rides here and there, countryside roads, and not really for the racetrack. Although, I mean, with a stiffened up chassis and so on, it's basically as sporty as the coupe. I mean, the difference you will, I think, only feel as a professional race driver, the stiffness in the chassis. Also from the weight, that the convertible is 150 kilograms heavier than the coupe, you do not feel that when driving. I mean, maybe again, if you're a very professional race driver and really can compare some, you know, tens of seconds in your lap time, maybe you realize it then. Other than that, I don't really think so. So, what about some Autobahn? Well, it's not Autobahn exactly today, because motorway near Barcelona is not German Autobahn. But it's also important to have that one here. Let's go to sport mode. We can have some more fun. Whoa. Yeah, it's, I mean, when this exhaust blops in, that's really something. And now already at about 80 kilometers, I feel there's a lot of wind coming in here, so really rather a convertible for summertime or for Miami Beach, for example. That would be a suitable occasion for that one. If you more think about, I want to go all season with the convertible and also all season open top, and maybe I also don't want to spend so much money, then an A5 or A3 convertible would show you better. I mean, you can even hear the sound still at such speeds here. And you can still make an Autobahn ride very enjoyable. As I think also when it's cold in winter, I try to drive with the with open top as often as possible when I have a convertible. It's just the most fun that you can really enjoy nature, and even sometimes when you're even stuck in traffic, you can still enjoy it. Here, all going over some bumps. Again, suspension is a great compromise between sportiness and comfort. Just when you're going through some potholes and you feel they have a sporty suspension, you kind of have a compromise at some point, but usually for the most use, this is really perfectly fine. So, what about this one here? I don't want to overtake on the right hand side, that's usually not allowed. Sometimes you just have to be gentle, just wait for your time to come, and everything will be fine. And we will also soon face a motorway crossing, and in the motorway crossing, we can also switch it around a little bit, have some more cornering. That's a lot of fun, definitely. But again, it's also fun just to cruise in this car. You know, there's also the Audi TT RS available, we have driven recently. And yeah, well, that one is basically a small Audi R8, you can say so. Here you feel that the car is longer and, of course, heavier, and has this longer and more sovereign super sports car feeling. However, the TT is, I think, the more agile car. You can say so, definitely. Now some bumps here on the road. Yeah, when some paintings are on the road, you do feel that. So the smaller stuff you feel more than the wide stuff on the road. That is even out pretty well, and, you know. Oh, what a handling here. I mean, no one can really catch up to you. If you look through this frameless mirror, you're up and gone, and that's it. It's really like a Formula One car, isn't it? And then again, going too deep. Relax, everything is fine. Sometimes you think you also smell something off the clutch, or maybe it's also from the car in front of us, I don't know. So what about handling the GPS while driving? Because, I mean, for example, I maybe want to switch motorways or something like that, or let's get off here. Fast lane change, always possible. How complicated is it to set a destination, for example? And again, I'm going to the nav menu. And for example, set it back again. If you have presets, then it's pretty easy to set. And for example, listening to the GPS or also to music has become easier here now, because while driving, we also have those speakers in the head restraints. We will also test that now when we, for example, listen to the GPS and see where we actually have to go. And there's also those speakers. In the seatbelt. So when I'm, for example, driving with open top and using the telephone, people can also hear me better. The voice of the GPS is very clear. Then what about some music?
Jetzt links fahren und danach rechts fahren.
It's very clear. Although it's open top.
Jetzt rechts fahren.
I'm not hearing the speakers from those ones too much though. At the moment not. But in general, the Bang & Olufsen sound system, the optional one, really gives you a very crisp and clear sound. It's so easy when you're just switching motorways here. This car is, it feels like you could go like 200 at any time, and of course it wouldn't have any problem with that. It's more the lacking of opportunity you usually have to really drive this car out. So that one will of course be better in Germany, in the German Autobahn, with maybe some parts of the unlimited speed. But again, life is not always about top speed, especially in a convertible. Sometimes you just accelerate a little bit, let the car decelerate a little bit, hit the brakes, and then listen to the exhaust, blop, blop. Or maybe the throttle blip when shifting down. So I hope you enjoy this trip here with me. It's always a lot of fun to go with the open top, definitely, and it just you know increases your overall general mood, no matter what happened before. Of course, when the sun is shining, Spanish motorways here are usually very restrictive as for the speeds. Therefore, we cannot do so much on the autobahn. But of course, a lot of time you're spending on the motorways. Therefore, it's always very important for car buyers also to see and to listen to how the car is really behaving in such situations. What a crazy car. Really a crazy car, I can tell you. And that's what one thing about super sports cars. You always feel that they are underrated in normal traffic, that you cannot really catch up to the whole potential. They have way too much power than you could ever use. I mean, think about it. Some people screaming to me something, I don't know. I mean, if you also think about the acceleration figures, 0 to 100 in 3.6 seconds, it's just 0.1 seconds difference to the coupe. And even 0 to 200 kilometers an hour, or 125 miles an hour, below 12 seconds, that's no a normal acceleration range to 100 for a normal car. So we cannot change the roof, close the roof at the moment, of course, because the maximum speed was 50 kilometers an hour, but still that's very high speed for closing the roof. So we're getting off the motorway here again, and have you for some beer? No, the next one. Getting off the motorway is also always a lot of fun. So that's the GPS, and GPS test worked well too. So good direction, and you can always have a good view, because the left side is the general overview and the right side is that you see the next intersection. So you have it all centered here, and for the driver that's really a good experience. For a co-driver, yeah, not everything could be seen that well, so that might be not that well for the co-driver. Well, the police is all around here. I think they're expecting to some Audi R8 going too fast or something like that. Probably some of our journalist colleagues will do so. We always refrain from doing that. I think there can also be a lot of fun with the cars without exceeding the speed limits. Back to the traffic here, and back to traffic lights. The only good thing about traffic lights is they always give you the chance to accelerate from standstill again. Some more of the sound experience right again. So there's another A6 in front of us, also from the official Audi crew. Now we see that with the IN number plates for Ingolstadt. And he also knows that I'm here now. Overdrive drive distribution is, by the way, I mean, depending on how slippery the surface is. Oh, well, that A6 has also a big petrol engine inside. But you feel that the car does have a rear wheel bias. And you could also deactivate the ESC, put it, for example, to ESC Sport, so that is possible. I do not recommend it for road driving. I mean, just better do it when you're maybe on the racetrack or something. That is more recommendable. Wow, nice, nice, nice. So at the moment when the road is dry, I don't feel so much when I'm going to the ESC Sport, but in those situations at the front where I was in the roundabout, where it's also a little bit wet, in this situation I would have to counter steer a little bit more and always be aware of that in normal street driving. This car also gives you enough sporty driving when you're just in the normal modes, definitely. So, I hoped you enjoyed some sound with me here, some sunshine, some of the agile parts. And again, if you want to see this car more burning out some fuel, you can always check the racetrack part of us. So that's still the classic deal, classic naturally aspirated engine, the real old school stuff, high consumption, a lot of performance, not putting down the displacement. If you want that, you can still get it here. Other than that, I don't know if we ever see. Electric Audi R8. I'm not sure. Maybe at some day, but not today. Now the conclusion of the R8 Spider in the new generation, refined as ever, we can really say. And I think also as a convertible, it has a nice outline if you, for example, compare it to the Coupé. I would put it in the Ara blue color we've seen earlier, not here in the Vegas yellow. Seeing your comments about that one, of course. Flawless in the build quality and also very sporty in the design with this driver focus, just that we're lacking some seat surface alternatives. Then the driving, we can really say this is the best super sports car on the market as for technology and driving dynamics, and I really mean that because I've driven a lot of them and I'm quite convinced of that. Of course, there's always a lot of emotional components involved, so you might say, you know, maybe a McLaren is more unique to me than an Audi R8. If you look at the facts, this one here is, in my opinion, the best super sports car there is on the market. Are there any downsides we've discovered? Yes, of course, the price and also the fuel consumption. Sometimes we couldn't really that well close the front hood, and sometimes the key wasn't found, so we have to hit the ignition again. Those ones were the flaws for today. Everything else really perfect in the building process, and I think they are also, especially in this respect, ahead of the competitors in this case. I hope you enjoyed. Looking forward to your feedback now here in our Autogefühl comments. And join us also next time, be it a super sports car or a cheaper everyday driving car. We got them all for you on Autogefühl, in the more resource for Indus Car Reviews with Thomas. Thanks for watching. Bye.